Welcome to Ring of Fire. I'm Farron Cousins, sitting in for Mike Papantonio. Here's what's coming up on today's show. The Republicans are once again beating the drums of war, but their latest action more closely resembles treason than national security. We'll bring you the details. And the movement to defund the Democratic Party has come in many different forms, and we'll explain how two of the largest efforts are succeeding. And oil train disasters are once again making headlines, so we'll take a look at why these accidents keep happening. We have all that and more coming up, but right now, you've stepped into the Ring of Fire.
You can't change Washington from the inside. You can only change it from the outside.
Grand jury secrecy rules.
For political gain.
The press can find out.
That has nothing to do with politics, but go ahead.
It wouldn't bother me.
Oops.
Fox News likes to ask the question, does Obama actually love America? Sure, it's a silly question, but it gets their base riled up over nothing. But recent activity by congressional Republicans shows that the GOP may actually be the party that's trying to take down America, as well as drag us into endless warfare in the Middle East. For more on this, let's go to Howard Nations. So, Howard, we have 47 Republicans that have sent this letter over to Iranian leaders. You know, tell us what's going on. You know, what's the purpose of this letter? Who did it go to? What in the world are these Republicans trying to do?
Well, I think what you see with this letter is the end of an era. It's a 70-year era of bipartisan cooperation with respect to foreign affairs. It's always been the rule that the President of the United States Executive Department conducts the foreign affairs of this country. It goes back to in 1945, 70 years ago, when Senator Arthur Vandenberg, the Republican from Michigan, who was a staunch isolationist, he was chairman of the Senate Foreign Relations Committee. But rather than opposing what Truman wanted to do after World War II, he gave what was acknowledged then as the speech heard around the world because it had worldwide implications. Senator Vandenberg said, "We must stop partisan politics at the water's edge." In other words, leave it to the executive to conduct foreign policy. The result of that bipartisanship was the Marshall Plan, the formation of NATO, the Truman Doctrine, which protected Greece and Turkey from going communist, and it created the modern European face that you see today, which would be considerably different if you had not had that bipartisanship. And the irony of it was that domestically, after doing all that in Congress, Harry S. Truman successfully ran against that Republican Congress as the do-nothing Congress and won re-election. You can only imagine what Truman would call today's Congress. But in that last 70 years, there's only been one instance of somebody interfering, and that was Nixon in 1968, who, as a presidential candidate, secretly communicated with South Vietnam while Johnson was in negotiation with them to try to end the Vietnamese war. It destroyed the deal, and the war dragged on for seven more years. Nixon clearly violated the Logan Act, which prohibits American citizens from communicating with foreign governments to conduct foreign policy.
So this letter from the Republicans, does this violate that Logan Act?
It doesn't reach that level. I think the consensus is it doesn't reach that level because they did it publicly. If they had done it in private, if they had done it secretly the way Nixon did, it would be a violation of the Logan Act. But it comes very close. But they sent a letter to the leaders of Iran, lecturing them on what our Constitution says. It was signed off on significantly by the Republican leadership and by potential presidential nominees, Marco Rubio, Ted Cruz, and Rand Paul. The goals of that letter are to kill the agreement, to pressure President Obama into giving some control over the process to Congress. And it was interesting that they lectured the Iranians on our Constitution when, in fact, the letter gets the Constitution wrong. Yeah. A Harvard law professor who was a member of the Bush administration says that it's an embarrassing error in the letter, especially he's embarrassed since Cotton got his law degree at Harvard. But it fails to mention that the threat, just the threat to withdraw from an agreement would violate international law. And the interesting thing is, Iran's foreign minister is the one who pointed that out and had to educate the Republicans in the Senate regarding our Constitution.
You know, that is so funny. You know, the situation itself, not funny at all. But the fact that these Republicans who always talk about needing to defend the Constitution, let's protect this Constitution, leaders in Iran, the country that they would be more than happy to go over and drop bombs on today, know more about the U.S. Constitution than a Harvard Law graduate who is a Republican congressperson.
And the other 40, and the other 46 senators who signed off on the same letter.
Exactly. I mean, but that just goes to show. I mean, these Republicans will say anything to get elected. They know just saying, let's protect the Constitution, it's a great talking point. It means nothing. There is no substance behind that statement at all, because it means absolutely nothing. You know, the only president in recent memory to really go against the Constitution was George W. Bush with the Patriot Act and destroying all those freedoms. But, you know, back to these war hawks, because I think part of what is happening here is they don't want an agreement. They know an agreement on any kind of nuclear deal is going to stifle the ambition that they have had for decades now, which is pretty much endless war in the Middle East. And Iran is the next target. We've already, you know, destroyed pretty much most of Iraq, but now ISIS is marching through Iraq and Syria and all those places. So they're chomping at the bit to get some ground troops there. And let's face it, they want another war with Iran. I think John McCain, with his little famous Bomb Iran song, really spelled out Republican foreign policy for us.
Yeah, they did. And there's no question that that's where they're aiming. As a matter of fact, this is all about the neocons' effort to get back into power. The neocons led us into Iraq with their lies, and with the major lies being those that were set up by the Cheney, for example. There is no doubt that Saddam Hussein now has weapons of mass destruction, and he's amassing them to use against our friends, our allies, and against us. Fast forward now to last week, when Netanyahu is addressing the Republican on invitations from the Republican addressing Congress. Iran is developing nuclear weapons to use against us and our allies, especially Israel. No need to negotiate. You notice one thing's missing. One thing's missing. They want to kill this. They want to kill this treaty. They want to kill this agreement. But they have no alternate plan. No alternate plan, because the alternate plan is the only remaining option, which is war. That's what they're trying to get to. So the neocons are just at it again. And the question is, has America learned nothing from 12 years of war?
Well, you know, that's a great point. There is no alternative plan, just like with everything else with the Republicans. Let's get rid of the Affordable Care Act. Okay, well, what's your plan? Well, we don't have one. Well, let's get rid of Social Security and welfare. All right, what do we replace them with? Well, we don't know. They don't know. And Peter King, a Republican, not that great of a guy, no offense, but he actually had the nerve to come out and say recently, we're not dealing with responsible, mature adults with these Republicans in leadership now. And when you have somebody like Peter King say, these people are not acting like adults, you know there is a problem with the party. And I've been very hard on Obama because it's not my job to be a cheerleader. It's my job to hold accountability. But he is dealing with what I see to really be the largest. He's running a daycare. That's what Washington, D.C. has become with these Republicans. It is a daycare. You almost expect to see them drawing with crayons all over the Constitution and just climbing up the walls. It is very, very scary that these people are leading this country, and I'm terrified about where they're leading us.
Well, this is more than just disrespect for Obama. This is now disrespect for the presidency itself. This is just the latest in a series of acts of total disrespect. Wilson calling Obama a liar during the State of the Union address, blatant interference with foreign policy, domestic policy also. Mitch McConnell recently wrote an editorial in which he says that states should refuse to comply with proposed rates on greenhouse gas emissions. EP regulations, which have the force of law, so you have the majority leader of the Senate calling on states to disobey the law. So it, and then it continues over on the House side, where the House Speaker invites the a foreign leader, Prime Minister Netanyahu, to address the Congress with the express purpose of criticizing the President of the United States on foreign policy and derailing foreign policy negotiations. So it's, it goes further than just disrespecting Obama. Now they're disrespecting the presidency, and that's why I think we're at the end of 70 years of bipartisanship in foreign relations.
There are no more gentlemen. There are no more adults at this point. Ed, that's the Republican Party. Howard, thanks for being with us today.
My pleasure, Farron.
If you've ever signed up for a cell phone or taken a loan from a bank, then you've probably unknowingly signed an arbitration clause that prevents you from suing the company if they don't uphold their part of the bargain. These arbitration clauses have become the standard for corporations, and they effectively strip away the rights from consumers to hold companies accountable. A recent Consumer Financial Protection Bureau report explains how these clauses are affecting consumers, and I have attorney David TeSelle here to talk about that report. David, a lot of people have signed these mandatory binding arbitration clauses all over the place. We have cell phones, we have banks, you know, anything really that you go and you have to sign some kind of contract. A lot of times people obviously can't sit there and read through this volumes and volumes of paperwork, so they'll sign it without realizing what's happening. What is going on with these arbitration clauses? What are they? Where do we unknowingly sign them? Give us all the background here.
Absolutely. Thanks for having me, Farron. The mandatory arbitration clause issue is a real big one for consumers in this country, but most people don't even know how big of a problem it is. If you ask people on the street, three quarters of the people that actually have these mandatory arbitration clauses in their agreements with banks and financial service providers don't even know it. So what is it? We're talking about a requirement that's written into the fine print of your agreement with your bank or your lender or your credit card company that takes away your right to take them to court if they mischarge you or treat you wrongly. You have no right to go to court. You have to mandatorily go to arbitration with them, which is outside of court, and which is something you have to pay for and actually go into a venue that takes away your rights.
And these arbitration panels that people go in front of, how are those skewed in favor of the corporation?
Well, that's a really good point. I think, Farron, why this is an important issue this week is that the Consumer Financial Protection Bureau, the entity that Elizabeth Warren helped create here in this country to actually monitor banks and to create regulations for banks, they actually came out with a study this week that finally brought together the empirical data of what's really going on in mandatory arbitration cases. And what we're finding, what they found in the report, is that when consumers have to go to mandatory arbitration, they are losing in overwhelming numbers. They're only winning a fraction of the time that they would otherwise be winning in court. And when the banks are actually bringing claims against the consumers, the banks are winning over 90% of the time in front of these panels. It's a stacked deck. I mean, it's forcing people to go into a rigged system, which means people typically don't want to bring claims if they don't think they can succeed.
Well, right, because a lot of times, obviously, the corporation is going to have a lot more money than average, you know, Joe Schmo consumer. Say, you know, you have a dispute over your cell phone service and you're up against a company, just cell phone company, AT&T. I don't know if they do it. I'm just using them as an example.
No, understood.
But, you know, AT&T has billions of dollars. They have very high-priced, powerful attorneys on their side. You, as a consumer, you don't have any of that. You would walk into an arbitration panel with an attorney that you'd probably just find through a quick search on the Yellow Pages or online, and you would be against this hugely stacked deck, and they could bleed you out forever in arbitration because they can afford it and you can't. I mean, that's just one of the many ways that this is stacked against the consumer.
Right, and absolutely. Also, another way that it's stacked against the consumer is these mandatory arbitration clauses all have what are called no class action provisions, or no class provisions, which means that you as a consumer can't join together with other people who are harmed in the same way to pool your resources and actually have a chance against the big banks with the billions of dollars and the big high-priced lawyers. Now, why is that important? What happens? I come, again, we'll use AT&T just as an example because they're a cell phone provider. And I get my bill, and I look at on my bill and I have a $50 charge for some fee that I know I didn't, it shouldn't be on there. And I call the customer representative at AT&T, and they don't do anything about it. Now, for $50, I'm going to have to hire a lawyer, I've got to pay AAA for an arbitration, and then I'm going to have to risk going up against a bank who's got a whole bunch of high-priced lawyers that are going to squash me anyway. I can't really fight that claim on the same level with these banks without a class action ability to go forward. This could be happening to a million of their consumers at the same time, all being mischarged $50 each. After a while, that's real money the bank is taking, and then there's no recourse to make them pay that back.
Well, it also gives corporations the ability to do things like that intentionally and knowingly, because they can pretty much say to the consumer, what are you going to do about it?
Right.
And that's not, you know, that's not just a hypothetical what if they started doing that. We've known that corporations right. do this for, I mean, basically since the first corporation ever became a corporation. I mean, that is why, you know, lawyers go through documents. We see internal things. We see emails and memos where they say, look, we know what we're going to do is wrong, but it's more it's financially better for us to do the wrong thing and then have to pay out later. And that's exactly what we're going to see, I'm sure, of what has been uncovered with these arbitration clauses.
And the myth that continues to be pushed in the media by the Chamber of Commerce and by the big companies is that somehow this keeps costs down, that somehow it's good for the consumer because they're actually saving money because of these arbitration clauses. The beauty of the Consumer Financial Protection Bureau's report, one of the things they looked at was a full five-year period. They looked at all the class actions, they looked at all the arbitrations, and they said there was no evidence at all to support that myth that the banks are trying to sell. You aren't saving any money by giving away your rights to go to court. In fact, you're losing money by doing that.
Right. And you just brought up the U.S. Chamber of Commerce, and they, you know, this report had only been out for a matter of hours before the U.S. Chamber of Commerce comes out publicly and says, I wonder if they're trying to protect consumers or if they're trying to protect plaintiff's lawyers.
Right.
That is almost the exact quote from the U.S. Chamber of Commerce.
Yeah, I've got the report right here. They wouldn't have been able to read it that quickly. They had their answer already pre-printed before it even came out.
Unbelievable. And so this really, you know, the U.S. Chamber of Commerce has obviously been pushing these arbitration clauses for a very long time. They're the most powerful player in getting these in place. And the U.S. Chamber of Commerce is also the leader in the tort reform movement, which we're going to be talking about later on in the show as well. But tort reform also comes from, one, protecting corporations, two, let's take money away from trial lawyers because they are one of the largest contributors to the Democratic Party. And so these arbitration clauses, while not under the banner of tort reform, they're pretty much tort reform by another name, aren't they?
Absolutely. I mean, the numbers in this report absolutely show that. For example, in the 2010-2011, that two-year period, they studied all of the arbitrations across the entire country that were brought, and there was only $175,000 awarded to consumers on the claims that were brought during that period. Yet at the same time, they looked at class actions that were filed by lawyers, and there was over $200 million of recovery for consumers and for people that were put in that position. It's striking. There's a stark contrast between what lawyers are able to recover for the consumer and what consumers are forced to go through with mandatory arbitration.
And one of the things everybody watching this needs to understand is that this is not about a payday for plaintiff's
right.
attorneys. That has nothing to do with this. I mean, people like you, you're a plaintiff's attorney. You go out there and you fight because people have been wronged. I mean,
right.
that's the whole thing. Mike Papantonio, who usually sits in this chair, he goes out and he does what he does, not because there's money, but because people have been wronged, and you guys have such a strong moral center that you know right from wrong versus these nameless, soulless corporations every day.
Correct.
And these corporations, they only see dollar signs. When they see people walking down the street, those people are dollar signs, and they want to know how they can get as much from that person as possible.
And if you don't stand up to the big banks and the big companies that are doing this, they will continue to take more and more of our money. They'll continue to send us into collapsed economies like we just had to go through in the 2008 timeframe. You have to stand up to them. And that's what we as plaintiff lawyers do to protect the consumer's right.
Is there anything, any way to get around signing one of these arbitration clauses, or with the way things are now, are you kind of stuck with it if you want this particular service? I have the list of credit cards, checking accounts, payday loans, prepaid cards, student loans, auto purchase, mobile wireless agreements. Can you even get any of these services, things that are almost essential in today's world, without having to sign one of these clauses?
And that's really what's insidious about it. It's not really a arm's length negotiation that you're in with your Wells Fargo bank or you're in with your payday loan lender. They give you these are included in the pre-printed forms. You are bound by it once you sign it. And so hopefully what this report that's come out this week will do is that Congress will now look at new regulations to limit or take away this mandatory arbitration without getting to our elected representatives and making them understand that we as consumers are concerned about this and want the regulations to change. There's nothing we on our own can really do about it.
And unfortunately, those same members of Congress, or members of the Senate, are the ones who are owned by these corporations. I wonder if they had to sign any arbitration clauses when they were purchased. Probably not.
I have a feeling they didn't.
But maybe it'll take... Maybe the 2016 Congress that gets elected, maybe they'll be a little better. I don't see that happening with the children that are in Washington right now.
Well, hopefully let's keep Elizabeth Warren continuing to talk about this, continuing to push this, and I think you just got to keep the message out there.
Right, absolutely, and that's what we're here for. David TeSelle, thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you.
In the last 2.5 years, more oil has been spilled by rail than at any other time in the last 4 decades. The increasing reliance of the oil industry on rail transport and the complete lack of federal oversight of our aging railway system has put millions of people at risk. Joining me now to talk about the growing danger from these oil trains is DeSmogBlog contributor Justin Mikulka. So, Justin, over the last couple years, really, we have seen this dramatic increase in the amounts of accidents in oil by rail. Not long ago, saw one of the first ones of this year. Go ahead and lay out what happened there.
Yeah, so this, as you mentioned, this story of oil by rail has really been developing over several years, starting with most of us became aware of it when an oil train carrying Bakken crude oil crashed in Lac-Mégantic, exploded. And what happened there, in hindsight, people looked at that and were asking the question, why did this train explode? Because everyone knows that crude oil doesn't explode. As more of those trains kept crashing and exploding, like the two that have in the last month in the U.S., we've learned that Bakken crude oil is explosive because it includes natural gas liquids, things like butane in it when it comes out of the ground. And the oil industry has chosen not to remove those before they put it in these rail cars. And also, we've learned just how slow and ineffective the regulatory process is, because that crash happened in July of 2013 in Lac-Mégantic. Here we are almost 2 years later. Trains are still crashing, still exploding, because essentially nothing has changed in that time period. So that aspect is trouble.
Well, I was going to say, the only thing really that has changed is the fact that we're seeing so much more of this. What's contributing to this increase? Are there just more oil cars out there, or has something fundamentally changed, perhaps with the aging railway system, with the regulatory system? Why is this becoming a frequent occurrence at this point?
Yeah, well, certainly this industry has ramped up. It really came out of nowhere. And there's so much of this oil being produced in North Dakota, the Bakken oil, that and there aren't pipelines there that go to the coasts where they want to refine it. So they just built a whole new industry to move it by rail and without any new regulations. And so we've seen the consequences of that. But now what we're seeing is a second phase of the oil by rail industry story, which is the tar sands oil from Canada is also very quickly ramping up and building the infrastructure to move a lot of that tar sands oil across North America, a lot of it through the U.S. to ports in the U.S. And so that's adding a whole second wave of volume and a lot more of these trains, the same tank cars, the same issues. But up until the two recent crashes of tar sands containing trains in Canada, it was assumed that these weren't explosive like the Bakken crude oil. And you know, I myself have been following this industry for more than a year, and I'd written that very thing in the past. And one of the reasons we thought that was because in the new proposed regulations that were put out last year that still haven't been put into place, the regulators said that when these unsafe tank cars, the DOT-111s, could no longer be used for explosive oil like Bakken, they expected they would be transferred to service to move this tar sands oil from Alberta. Says that right in the proposed regulations. And what's frightening about that is now that we know that these two tar sands trains have crashed and exploded just like the Bakken oil, and looking into that over the past couple of weeks, it makes total sense, because what the way they move tar sands oil is they dilute it, because tar sands itself, the bitumen, is a very thick tarry substance. To be able to pump it through a pipeline or put it into a rail car, they dilute it. But what they're diluting it with is natural gas condensate, which is the exact thing that makes Bakken oil explosive. So they're intentionally adding the dangerous elements to it to make it easier to ship. And if you look at, I found the industry safety data sheets for this dilbit, the diluted bitumen, they have it classified as the same classification as a flammable liquid as the Bakken oil that was involved in Lac Mégantic. So they know it's explosive. And so but that's been a revelation. And it also, it shows just, unfortunately, how little the regulators who are writing these regulations know about the products. Hopefully it wasn't intentional that they were just kind of doing a bait and switch and saying that they could use these unsafe cars for tar sands, but shows there's a real problem in the whole process.
Well, one of the biggest problems obviously is the lobbying. I mean, we do the rail industry in general, a huge, hugely powerful player in Washington, D.C. and American politics, but it's not a lobby that anybody ever really talks about because, you know, up until now, it's trains. Trains seem so old-fashioned to us, but really, you know, transport by rail, especially with this, Bakken oil, the tar sands from Canada, that they're making explosive, which that's phenomenal. I didn't know that. I'm sure most of our viewers didn't know that. That they pull it out of the ground, it's not explosive, and they are essentially adding the explosives to it before they send it through, and that is unbelievable. But it's the lobbying from both the dirty energy industry, from the rail industry, that is helping to keep regulators, one, in the dark, and two, essentially powerless to do anything about this. I mean, is that, you know, about the 10,000 foot?
There's been an excellent example of the power of the lobbyist and just how hard they are working to avoid new regulations. When the last Bakken train crashed in the U.S. in Galena, Illinois, the day after that crash, the American Association of Railroads and most representatives of most of the major players in the rail industry were meeting with regulators at the White House to argue against new regulations. And the two things that they were arguing against were that they don't want to put modern braking systems on these, you know, these unit trains of oil that can be like a mile long, these massive trains. They don't want to have modern brakes, and they don't want speed limits. And so that was the day after the crash in Galena. An oil train crashed in Canada the day after that meeting. But so in the midst of this unfolding disaster, they are arguing that the last thing they want is modern brakes and or speed limits. So the brazenness of the industries is incredible. And the effectiveness also, a story that came out this week about the oil industry lobbying efforts regarding this. One of the things I've been writing about over the past year is that if you stabilize this Bakken oil, which is a simple process that the oil industry does in other cases, you take out those natural gas liquids that make it explosive, you wouldn't have the danger of these exploding trains. And the oil industry has lobbied against that throughout this process, and they haven't been required to do it. And there's nothing in the proposed regulations that would require them to do that. Reuters reported a story this week. They had some White House officials say that last year, Transportation Secretary Anthony Fox went to the White House to talk about these regulations and his concerns about the explosive nature of the oil. And apparently the word came from President Obama's chief of staff himself saying, yeah, we're not going to include that in the regulations. So the biggest issue, safety issue, is this oil is explosive. And they can make it non-explosive by stabilizing it. And the word came directly from the White House. The word came from the oil industry, obviously. But the rail industry is doing the same thing right now. The braking systems on most of these trains were described at an NTSB hearing last year as 19th century technology. So they're just doing the least they can to be able to move as much of this oil as fast as they can.
So they want no speed limits. Let us go as fast as we can. They don't want new brakes. Let us not be able to stop. I mean, based on what we've seen and what we know, this clearly is a recipe for disaster. Unfortunately, we're out of time here, but this is a phenomenal story. You've done some great work on it. Justin Mikulka, keep it up. Thank you for being with us.
Thank you.
Republicans have been pushing the idea of tort reform, which is financial caps on lawsuits, for several decades, and some states have put these restrictive laws in place. But the data is telling us that the tort reformers' promises of lower medical costs and increased economic activity haven't materialized. And I have Will Atkinson from the Cochrane firm with me to tell us what's really happening in tort reform states. Will, the whole tort reform movement has been around for decades now, since the 1970s. And really the entire goal of this movement, it wasn't so much about protecting doctors. The real goal of it was to hurt the trial lawyers and to hurt consumers and protect, the interest of big business. So we've had states all over the country that have enacted these tort reform laws. Go ahead and take us through, what has happened so far in the tort reform movement.
Right. So the tort reform laws were really passed to increase the bottom line of the insurance companies, big business, and other special interests. And it really began in the 1980s. These insurance companies were looking for a way to increase their bottom line, and they've been, unfortunately, successful at passing these measures. 30 of 50 states have these tort reform laws, and they've limited the ability for individuals who have been suffered serious injuries from others' negligence to receive justice. A recent study in the New England Journal of Medicine found that that tort reform did not reduce healthcare expenses, it did not reduce these so-called defensive medicine practices. Tort reform was sold on lies. It basically said that if we enacted these measures, businesses would come into the states, healthcare costs would go down, and medicine would be safer. None of that has turned out to be true, and there's been a myriad of significant studies on this, and basically, tort reform was sold on lies, and it's just resulted in insurance companies and businesses making more money, individuals who've been injured not receiving their fair compensation.
Well, the lies are the big part here, because one of the biggest ones, too, is the fact that they told us if we don't enact these tort reform measures, your doctor is going to leave the state. Your doctor is going to go somewhere else where they have medical malpractice liability caps, which are typically in the range of about $250,000. And, one of the best ways to explain what a medical malpractice cap of $250,000 means for a person, here it is. Suppose you have a 24-year-old, otherwise healthy male who goes in for a procedure, maybe to have a leg removed for some reason. Maybe he's been injured and he has his leg removed. Well, if they remove the wrong leg and that man then comes to sue for malpractice, he would only get $250,000from a lawsuit in a state where tort reform has been enacted. That $250,000 for an otherwise healthy 24-year-old man would amount to about $4 a day for the rest of his life for cutting off the wrong leg. And it's the same thing with anything. You know, they leave a sponge in you that causes sepsis, and you, you know, internal organs are infected with diseases that almost destroy your body. You're talking about $250,000, which is nothing for all the pain and suffering these people go through. It really amounts to several dollars a day. That's a cup of coffee at a Starbucks. I mean, it's pathetic.
Right.
And as you pointed out, it was sold completely on lies. And now we have one of the most comprehensive studies ever that shows none of those lies ever became a truth. I mean, the evidence shows none of it happened.
That's right. And these people are suffering serious injuries. There's a 1999 study, really a seminal study, in the Institute of Medicine, which is at the U.S. National Academy of Sciences. And it found that 44,000 to 98,000 people are killed in hospitals due to preventable error every year. The best way to increase patient safety is to increase patient safety initiatives. You only have to look at the practice of anesthesiology. In the 1980s, that practice was subject to multiple large verdicts. And in response, the practice increased training, monitoring, safety devices, and other safety initiatives. And what happened was the mortality rate for anesthesiology went from 1 in 6,000 to 1 in 200,000. That's more than 333% improved chance of survival. And that's from torts and lawsuits. And those are precisely the things that the justice that the Chamber of Commerce and others want to prevent.
Well, you know, one of the things that I think a lot of people miss about medical malpractice, and, you know, it is a great fear whenever you go in for a surgery that something is going to go wrong due to doctor error. That is the third highest cause of death in the United States today. However, less than 5% of the doctors in this country are responsible for more than 90% of the medical malpractice claims. You know, these tort reform measures were put in place based on, you know, statistics that weren't there. I mean, if we understood that less than 5% of the doctors in the United States are the ones responsible for almost all of the malpractice, I mean, that really shifts, the figures there. Plus, you have to figure, you know, you've got such a remarkably low rate of return on a medical malpractice lawsuit. You know, they're not typically won. They're not typically huge verdicts or settlements. And, you know, frequently they're lost because it's very hard to say this doctor ruined my life when on the one hand you also say the doctor saved my life. So you have to prove such horrible, horrible cases of negligence that there really is no lawsuit epidemic when it comes to malpractice suits, is there?
That's right. That's another lie that was sold. They basically claimed that the court system was clogged, that all these out-of-control juries were awarding Powerball-sized verdicts to plaintiffs with negligible cases. 1% of adverse medical events result in a legal action. It's not as if people are filing baseless medical malpractice lawsuits. Part of the tort reform, the components of these laws is now they require that you have to get an opinion of a doctor signed. You have to hire him as a lawyer. It's expensive. They also decrease the percentage that a lawyer receives. Basically, they want to make it uneconomical for lawyers to be able to bring these cases. And it's been successful. It's much harder if you've been injured in a hospital to find a lawyer who will take your case, because it's just simply uneconomical. And you're right that it's a small percentage of doctors that are accounting for the vast majority of malpractice claims. Maybe they just shouldn't practice medicine. And even beyond that, it's unconstitutional.
Right. I mean, that's the bottom line, is that we're taking away people's rights. And there's no way to shape that in a way that actually makes sense. And Will, I wish we had more time to talk about this, but unfortunately that's all we have. But thank you for telling us about this story today.
Thank you, Baron.
Recently, Mike Papantonio spoke with journalist Amanda Marcotti about the revelation that many Tea Party Republican super PACs are scamming conservative voters. Let's take a look at that interview.
Amanda, it seems like the conservatives have been scamming the American public politically for so many decades, I've lost count. But now we find out that the scams are a little more direct. It seems that they're kind of taking advantage of fear and anxiety to collect big, big bucks for themselves. Tell us this story. Very good story that you wrote here, conservatives still scamming the base. Very well done. Give us the 10,000 foot on this.
So basically, one of the things that, and I definitely give credit to organizations like Media Matters for really keeping track of this, one of the ongoing problems in the conservative movement is that a lot of their leaders and pundits and politicians are basically running long-term mail order scams on their actual followers. So like you see a Mike Huckabee or Ben Carson or guys like that, they create these big old, Newt Gingrich is a really bad one for this. They create these email lists of followers and supporters, and they use these lists to just spam them relentlessly with asks like advertisements for BS insurance scam or
cancer cures or let me ask you this. Okay, so it begins with we have to collect the emails, right? And that maybe is Mike Huckabee running for president. He collects the email list. Or Newt Gingrich runs for president. He collects the email list. Then they get together with some huckster, some scammer, and says, look, I can cure cancer. And so I want to use your email list for this fake cure of cancer or Alzheimer's disease or whatever it may be. And we want to use what you've collected and go after these conservatives. Now, you also see this with political PACs. I mean, you have a political PAC that is out there saying, you know, if you were really angry about in your article, you talk about if you were angry about, say, maybe Jeb Bush getting into the race in Florida, past governor, now is going to run for president. If you don't like that, send us money and we'll solve the problem. What do they do with money like that? Typically, what's the split with money like that? When some, you know, Tea Party conservative says, oh, I'm going to give this money so I can stop Jeb Bush. What happens next?
You see about 1 to maybe 5% of the money that you donate to these political PACs actually going to candidates. You know, a really good example or bad, depending on how you want to see this, is Sarah Palin. She started the Sarah PAC, and, you know, she just spams all these followers all the time with, like, asks for money, promising them that if they give Sarah Palin money, she will turn around and help elect conservative candidates to office. It seems that most of the money that you give her goes to Sarah Palin.
okay, but your article talked about, you know, if they're spending $205,000, if that's the typical kind of money collected, about 7% of that might actually go to what she says it's going to go to. Is that an accurate number?
Yes, yeah, okay. That is exactly right. And so, you know, basically it's just a bunch of, and the thing is that's frustrating about this is, like, one of the reasons that conservative politicians and figures get away with this is because, you know, let's be honest here, the right is, like, predominantly older. There are a lot of elderly people that are Republicans and conservatives, and, you know, they're kind of ripe for being attacked in just this way.
Well, they're used to sending $25 to Pat Robertson, aren't they? I mean, Pat Robertson is on the 700 Club, has been kind of getting them ready for this whole thing. Send money and miracles happen. And so the miracles here are kind of political miracles or cancer cure miracles or Alzheimer's disease miracles. And they are particularly gullible, aren't they? I mean, they are kind of really prey to this, aren't they?
Yeah, I mean, it really goes to show that you see that the conservative leaders know that their followers must be gullible, first of all, to follow them. But what you definitely see is kind of this huge machine that stokes a lot of fears and panic, unnecessary fears and panic in often elderly people, elderly white people that are often not necessarily like that plugged into the world. They watch a lot of Fox News and they start to think the world is going to hell and that we're on the verge of having an apocalypse and race riots and whatnot. And so they sign up for Mike Huckabee's email listserv. And in there, there's a bunch of advertisements for when the apocalypse comes, you need to buy gold or buy
survivalist gear.
And stuff like that. And they're just basically robbing these people blind. And, you know, like on one hand, it's tempting to write it off as like, well, you know, suckers deserve what they have, deserve what's coming to them. But on the flip side, it's like, you know, a lot of these people are, you know, they're paranoid and they're conservative, but they aren't necessarily bad people. You know, a lot of them are people I suspect that we have in our own families, and we should be concerned that they're spending their retirement savings.
Well, okay, but you know what? If you ran this by 10 people who have watched all this develop over the last few decades, and you've seen this hate and this anger and this paranoia, this fear that just seems to absolutely saturate every bit of this, you know, this kind of elderly conservative mentality, it is very difficult to have much sympathy for this. I mean, look, we both agree on this. Most of this is driven by fear and anxiety, and that's what the Mike Huckabees and the Eric Ericsons and the Newt Gingriches, this is what they capitalize on. But at some point, I guess if I was a Republican, I would be saying it's the market taking care of itself, because that really is their mantra. You know, gee whiz, the weak get gobbled up. Well, in this situation, you've got Republicans who are gobbling up their own people. Now, let's shift over to the political side of it, though. I mean, you've got people who actually run for office knowing they don't have a snowball's chance in hell to ever win. You know, Mike Huckabee, it's almost a caricature of that. I mean, every day it's some kind of ridiculous, outrageous statement that he makes, and he knows it doesn't have any national appeal. There's no way it's going to float nationally. So why does he run? He runs to make money, doesn't he?
Yeah, exactly. And we saw that in 2012, and we're going to see it again in 2016. If you want to know why the Republican primary had so many candidates in it that they had trouble getting them all on stage, this is exactly why.
It's a moneymaker.
It's all about the money. It's all about the Benjamins. Like, they run for president. They use this national platform. All this, basically, it's a way to get free advertising for your email listserv. And to get somebody else to sort of pay for it. You know, you do all this fundraising to run, so you don't have to pay for it out of pocket.
Right. Now, they live on this, too, though. I mean, let's be clear. They can live on this. Not like anybody tells them they can't spend it on anything in particular. Isn't that accurate?
I think, it kind of depends. I mean, campaign fundraising, there are restrictions on how you can spend that
but
money.
But they're minor. I'm telling you, I've looked at this very minor. It's amazing what these people can actually live on this money. I mean, if you figure they're traveling around and eating and whatever it is. So right now, if we assume that it has become a business, the business of running for president is a money-making business, then all of a sudden, your point is, we're going to see a lot of people on stage, and it's not going to really have much to do with qualifications. I mean, everybody that, you know, looks into Ben Carson's eyes more than 10 seconds knows this guy is going nowhere. Same with Huckabee. Same, we knew that with Sarah Palin. But if it's such a business, why isn't the Republican Party saying, you're killing us? I mean, in a sense, it's killing the Republican Party on a lot of different levels. First of all, the Clown Brigade is out just completely decimating what used to look like anything that's left of a viable, intelligent message that the Republicans were trying to develop. That's the first problem. But then the second problem is you've got the Ben Carsons and the Mike Huckabees and the Newt Gingriches, Sarah Palins that are just the Marco Rubios that are just sucking money away from candidates that might have a chance. That happened to Huntsman. I mean, if you think about it, the last go-round, that happened to Huntsman.
Yeah, and you're beginning to see some Republicans starting to speak out against it, but I've noticed that they very narrowly only speak out at what they consider bad PACs that suck away money from legitimate candidates. I noticed that they don't speak out against other scams, such as running for president in order to get an email listserv and sell cancer cures and survivalist gear to people. And I think, you know, they are trying to encourage people to give money to PACs like American Crossroads and stuff that are actually successful in accomplishing the goals of getting electing candidates to office.
But percentage-wise, you know, Amanda, the percentage-wise, as I read the Politico had an article on this too, and, you know, when I take a look at the percentages of which one of these PACs, these political PACs, are actually doing any good for a particular candidate, it's very few. I mean, out of 10, there may be two. And so you just wonder the leadership of the Republican Party. Of course, the Democrats have to love this because all you're doing, you know, all they're doing is wasting money. You have Republicans wasting money on Ben Carson's and Mike Huckabee's. That's a huge benefit for the Democrats, isn't it?
Yeah, you know, I think that it is. And I think that's why you're beginning to see some Republicans speaking out against this specifically. But I think that has to be, I think that one of the reasons Republicans are somewhat reluctant to speak out about this too loudly is because the legitimate candidates kind of benefit in these sort of abstract ways from the clown brigade, as you call it.
Sets them apart, you mean?
Yeah. So like Mitt Romney, really good example. You know, he gets up on stage with a bunch of clowns and a-holes, and he looks better by comparison.
Mm-hmm.
And then he can go around and say things that are just completely false. He can just be a right-wing nut of the worst sort.
And they still sound intelligent.
He still seems kind of not that bad because at least he's not Mike Huckabee or Newt Gingrich. And so I think there's a certain kind of reluctance amongst Republicans to speak out too loudly about this because, you know, not only do the Mitt Romneys benefit, but they like that their followers are suckers. They like that they can get them to kind of do whatever they want, and they're not going to upset that apple cart.
Isn't that just a deplorable, pitiful state of conservative politics? Eric Erickson, let's talk about him a little bit, because there's a lot of Eric Ericksons out there, aside from the politicos like Sarah Palin and Huckabee and Newt Gingrich, that are just sucking money away from these poor victims. I have no sympathy for them. Let me be very clear. I have zero sympathy for these victims. I know you do in your article, and I understand that. But, chickens come home to roost. But at any rate, Eric Erickson is doing the same thing that maybe the Glenn Beck is doing, or O'Reilly, or, you know, O'Reilly uses it to sell books. Erickson uses it to sell what? I mean, Erickson's selling something in some form of fashion, isn't he?
Yeah, Eric Erickson. It's interesting because Eric Erickson has been on the record speaking out about the PACs that divert money from legitimate candidates to people like Sarah Palin, who just spend it on nonsense and garbage. But he won't speak out against, you know, the email fraud that's going on, the cancer cures and survivalist gear and whatnot. And part of that is he himself makes money off of that.
How does he respond to that? I mean, you know, when you say, Eric, you know, you're out here as a voice saying this is all bad, that basically PACs are stealing money from Tea Party type conservative old people that are afraid of every damn thing, and they're stealing money from those people. How is what you're doing any different? What's his response to that?
You know, Politico actually asked him this, and he kind of lamely said, you know, I don't like that my email list gets used by Newsmax in this way. And that's literally all he would say about it. But it kind of kills you because it's like, well, then why don't you stop selling them access to your email list?
Mm. You don't sound optimistic that anything is going to change going into 2016 for these this, these poor ordinary victims. But the truth is, do you see any inroads at all? I mean, I'm just wondering whether you expect anything to change in 2016, or is it going to get worse?
You know, that's a really good question, and I don't know, because I would say that the mail order scam thing on the right has been going on for 50 years now. This is nothing new. That's what's interesting about this. The conservative movement has been about creating email lists, but it used to be just mailing address lists that they would create. And they would use conservative publications and, you know, candidacies and all that to create these lists and then just hit people with all sorts of scams, gold bug stuff and other things like that. Mm-hmm. This has been going on since the 1950s and the John Birch Society and everything like that. Now, what's changed is with Citizens United, they've been able to create these super PACs that have very little regulation. That it's very difficult to get them to not do what they're doing, which is to hit people with all these kind of scary appeals and then take their money and then not use it for what they said they were.
Yeah, in other words, you have another wall up there that actually prevents anybody from actually taking action. Amanda, this is a great story. I hope to have you on as the 2016 approaches, and we can talk about how much more money is being squandered on the Huckabee types. And so, you know, again, my position is, you know, great. This is a great story. Thanks a lot. Thanks for joining me.
Thank you.
That's it for this week's Ring of Fire, but you can keep up with us throughout the week online at ringoffireradio.com, on Twitter at Ring of Fire Radio, and on Facebook. I'm Farron Cousins, and we'll see you next week right here on Ring of Fire.